Okay. Anyway, earlier I was talking about the interview with Max Cuento with the Outreach Magazine, and they're talking about the increase of anxiety in the United States and, of course, even here in Canada. And according to one of the psychologists, the level of stress of an average patient in 1950 is the same level of stress that children of our time are having. It's that much. And another thing too is the level of anxiety is increasing, and particularly sharply in the United States. There is more anxiety in the United States than in the developing world. And also that we're seeing that when people from developing countries move to the US, their anxiety increases. Why is that? We think that when we were back home, we like to go to the US, Canada, US, so that our life will be much easier, much prosperous, and we will get more peace and joy. But according to the study now, it is not what is happening right now. The people from developing countries, when they go to the States, to the US, to the West, their level of anxiety increases. And the reason are these two things. Our secularism is increasing, which removes God from our conversation. We are too secular that when we talk, when we converse with other people, we remove God in our conversation. Especially now, we know that there is so much law that preventing us to talk about God. And that is one reason why anxiety is increasing. Another one is our level of information exposure is increasing. When we hear the bad news, terrorism, and some other bad thing that is happening in the world, in the past, our grandparents, when it happens, let's say it happens in the Middle East or in the US, before it hits them, it will take weeks or months before they know about it. But now, all this bad news, as soon as it happens, with all our gadgets, our phone, internet, and Facebook and everything, if it happens in the US now, in 2 seconds or so, we will get that.
Yes.
And so much of this information that we don't have time to digest it. We cannot digest this bad thing that is happening in the world. This is causing the people, even children, to be anxious. That is a sad thing. And is there any solution to that? The question is, do we have solution? In our text, we are told that this good news will cause great joy to every people. To every people. And this good news is the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ, the Savior. This baby is born. And this baby will cause good news of great joy to everyone. And why, you may ask, why is this good news of great joy, I don't see it everywhere. This is supposed to be to all the people. But this is only if you have the Savior. Because this good news of great joy was announced by the angel to the shepherd. And he said, because today in the town of David, a Savior is born. A Savior is born. So the question is this Savior your Savior? Do you have him in your heart as your Savior? Who is this born a Savior? Who is this born a Lord, King? Can he really give solution to this problem of anxiety, to this fearful world? Can he really do that? How can we be sure? This baby, remember, this is a baby, and he was born by a virgin. He is a virgin-born baby. And the first question is, do you really believe in a virgin birth? In a virgin birth? Do you really believe that? Even as a Christian, even as a believer, have you ever questioned that? I would think, maybe not. We just take it for granted that Jesus is born by a virgin. But this thing, this doctrine about virgin birth, is the pivotal doctrine about being a believer and not a believer. This will separate us from the true believer and a believer. Virgin birth. He is born by a virgin. If we don't believe, if we will deny the virgin birth, soon we will deny the supernatural. Because virgin birth is not a natural thing. This is a supernatural thing. Christian religion is not a natural thing. It is a supernatural thing. And if we deny the supernatural, then we will deny, later we will deny the miracles. And if we deny the miracles, then we will deny that Jesus feed the 5,000. He did not feed the 4,000. He did not raise the dead. He did not give sight to the blind. He did not make the lame walk. Because this is all miracles. And if we deny the virgin birth, we will deny the supernatural, and as you deny the supernatural, you will deny the miraculous. And if we deny the miraculous, then Jesus did not die on the cross, he did not raise from the dead. And if he did not raise from the dead, how can he save you and me? He cannot. Because if Jesus is not a virgin birth, then his father is Joseph. And his mother is Mary. And then he is just like you and me. A sinner. Born a sinner. How can he save you if he is just like you and me? A sinner. So, this doctrine of the virgin birth is so important. We must accept it, believe it truly, if we are to believe in the Christian faith. We must believe that this baby is born by a virgin. It is important, it is significant. Matthew talked about it, Luke wrote about that, and it is prophetic. It was prophesied in Isaiah 7:14. Isaiah says that the virgin will give birth, and that happened in Bethlehem. It did happen in Bethlehem. So, we believe that this baby is born by a virgin. He is to be a savior, and he did. He died on the cross for you and me. And the purpose, the very purpose of his birth is your salvation and my salvation. He was born so that you will be saved. So that we will have a Savior. But that is a choice. It is a choice. We have to choose to accept him as our Lord and Savior. Because he is the one who died for our sin. That is our biggest problem, the sins that we committed. We cannot take for that. Only Jesus is the one who can pay for it, because he is the one.